So I will talk about the arithmetic toolbox in the SIGAL library. So SIGAL is the computational geometry algorithms library. I will first give a very brief overview of what SIGAL is, and then I will try to introduce you what the robustness, numerical robustness issues are that we are facing in this project. And after that, I will give some details about the arithmetic tools that we have in SIGAL to solve those problems. So here goes with a very brief overview. So it's a now 20 years old project that started in European academia. These days it's mostly commercial. It's a large C++ project, about 1 million lines of code, mostly templates and geometric algorithms. It has two licenses, so the same code is available under either GPL or commercial license. And it's a rather good success on the commercial front, so there's dozens and of customers in various domains where there is a need for geometry. So I listed them here, GIS, CAD/CAM, historically, geophysics, medical domain too. The library in itself has some key design goals that were set from the start. The first is that it needs to be application independent, and so there is a lot of genericity in it. In C++, that means heavy template use. But also, the algorithms are independent of the application domains. And then there is the robustness. So the algorithms need to be to not crash in face of data that comes from various domains, so different distributions and kinds of data. And it needs to be efficient enough for whatever it's trying to do. Here are some pictures for examples. So here you have a polygon, which is a map. And with SIGAL, you can actually triangulate those polygons. So create a graph, adding dots to mesh the interior. You can do meshes. So mesh generation is a large part of SIGAL. Here you have this butterfly shape, and you can say, okay, let's generate a mesh of the inside of this polygon. You can set it without any constraints, so it's going to only produce triangles that are relatively well-shaped, so not too skinny, for example. You can select a uniform size of your triangles, so it's going to be much more dense. Or you can set a size function that depends on various parameters. So here, for example, we want it to be more refined at the top end of the wing of the butterfly, and the rest is okay with large triangles, for example. That's the kind of things that you can do.
Why don't we find the same triangles on the left and on the right and on the bottom?
Why? Sorry?
So why don't we have the same triangles?
Look at the top.
No, but yeah. The bottom.
Oh. The way it's generated by refining the mesh incrementally, roughly.
Okay.
And so if you have some effect that is caused at some end, it can have consequences elsewhere.
Okay.
Essentially, well, I won't go into details of this here, but it's local and global. You have another set of things that you can do with SIGAL, which is Boolean operations, which are based mostly on arrangements. There you can do union, intersections, or complements of polygons. And those polygons, they can be defined as line segments, but also curves. So for example, circular arcs or Bezier curves. That's what is supported. Here is yet another example, a Voronoi diagram of line segments. So here you have, you start from a set of segments and you want to regroup the points of the plane that are closer to each of those segments. And so these define regions, the Voronoi cells, which are bounded by either line segments or parabola arcs. So there you have a little bit of algebra that comes in. Another example, so now it's in 3D, something I worked on with Monique a lot, which is the 3D Delaunay triangulations and the weighted version of it. it's really at the core of volumic meshes, so it's very important that it's very robust and efficient. So a lot of work has been done, has been put into it. Here it's just yeah, like a triangulation in the plane, but you connect the data with tetrahedrons. Okay, and what you can do on top of it is, so volumic meshes. Here it's an image of the brain where you want to, you separate all the various areas of the brain in separate colors. Hopefully you see those here. Okay, so that was just a set of examples of stuff that is done in SIGGAN, but there are dozens more of these things. Okay, now the robustness issues. So this comes when you analyze how the algorithms are implemented. At the lower level, when you compute DNA triangulation, for example, you need these two primitives. So we call them the orientation and in-circle predicates. So the orientation predicate is you take three points in the plane, P, Q, and R, and you want to decide, you want to compute on which side of the line PQ lies the point R, if it's on the left, on the right, or on exactly on the line. The in-circle predicate is you take four points, P, Q, R, that define a triangle with a circumscribing circle, and you want to know if the fourth point S is on the circle, inside, or outside. So we have lots in SIGGAN, I mean dozens also of predicates, which are functions that take numerical input, typically points or line segments or small objects, and they return the result of a decision. So it's a Boolean or it's a discrete result, inside, outside, or on something.
So for the orientation on in circles, there are three possible answers.
Yes.
Left, right, or exactly.
Yes.
On the
yes. It is. It boils down to, if you express your points as Cartesian coordinates in the plane, then it boils down to the sign of a determinant.
Yeah. Okay.
And this one too. And on the other side, we have what we call constructions, which are small routines that take small geometric objects and they produce new geometric objects. So an intersection of two line segments, which generate a new point. Or a circumcenter of three points. Okay, so that's two categories. Now, what happens if you evaluate predicates using floating points as a straightforward evaluation? So, as I said, the orientation predicates of PQR is the sign of a 2x2 determinant. So it's this simple formula there. Now, if we zoom, if we take three points, so those P, Q, and R's that are specified on the right, so P has some coordinates, one half and one half, and Q is at 24, 24, so just on the simple x equals y line. And then we zoom in close to point P, and we look at the result of orientation computed with floating point, when the point R is very close to P. So that's just, I think when you zoom in, this square here corresponds to maybe 256 consecutive floating point values. So it's just a very close zoom. And this is the result that you get. Ideally, if it was computed with real numbers, you will have one diagonal which is yellow. This would be negative, so blue and red. And obviously you get, with the rounding errors, you get some changes. You even get inversions here, so you have a red dot that is on the incorrect side of it. So, I mean, everybody here knows that, but it's just a very visual way to do it. And we see that this kind of problem is going to lead to issues with algorithms, because the consequences can be that, okay, either you have a wrong output, okay, maybe your triangulation is not the best one, okay, but maybe it's still valid, if it's good enough. It can be very wrong. You can have a point that is that has been computed in a way that was very unstable and goes to infinity or close to it. You can have a crash because your algorithm hits the violation of an invariant. You have checks, and one of those checks gets hit. You can have infinite loops. So for example, when you try to locate a point in a triangulation, you do that iteratively. And if you take bad decisions with this orientation predicate, you can enter a loop. So the consequences, all the geometric algorithms that are proved with real numbers in the real RAM models, using floating point naively, that just does not really work. So it's a well-known problem, and historically, so the easy solution, very easy, is to say, okay, maybe the problem is around zero. So if you consider a thick line, if a value that you want to compute the sine on is smaller than a well-chosen epsilon, you just consider that it's zero. But of course, this solution has some issues, like it's not nice for transitivity, so it does not really generalize very well. There are some variants of it that can be made to work for some specific problems, but it's a bit hard. And it's not very beautiful in a mathematical sense, not very general. So there is a more general solution, which is what we have adopted in CI, which is expressed as the exact geometric computing paradigm. The idea is that to guarantee robustness, it's enough to make sure that all the decisions within the algorithm, they are taken as if real arithmetic has been used. And so if you do that, then all the theoretical proofs of the algorithms apply, and therefore you have some robustness. So how do we do that? If you consider very simple, but also very common problems that only use, let's say, rational numbers, then instead of floating point, you can just use multiple precision arithmetic, and it will work. The issue is that depending how you do it, it's very easy to be at least 100 times slower, at least historically when we started it. Now with the latest MPF4 and GMP, maybe that's a bit better, but still you have an overhead if you switch very directly to it. But it works. So the idea is, what we do is to have some kind of refinement of precision. It's not general in a sense like let's say IRAM or other things that, let's say, are going to, for example, increase precision in an exponential way, doubling precision at each time, for example. It's never been that needed in our case. So what we tend to do is mostly machine precision first, and if it fails, then just use something very costly but completely exact.
My solution is a solution. Don't we have the same problem that we can't test for zero? That it will just be at a closer zoom?
Okay, so there, that's why I have rational expressions in there.
It's
not so for rationals, you can do that. So the assumption here, the general assumption here is that you have an arithmetic engine that is going to be able to compute exactly the sine of something that you need. Now, you can do that for some expressions. You can do that if it's a rational thing, right? You just use GMP rationals, for example. You can also do that for algebraic numbers. Okay, and that's essentially all we care about. But I agree that
So this multiple precision is rational numbers potentially, and not MPFR.
Yeah, I will go a little bit beyond with algebraic stuff, but yeah, mostly it's very simple expressions. In terms of arithmetic, so there is the multiple precision, and usually we do the first step of what we call filtering, which is done at the machine precision. So it's interval arithmetic, and you compute your determinant, for example, with intervals, and if you want to get the sign, you can most of the time decide using intervals. If you do that at the first step, then the overall algorithm tends to be about 10 times slower than just using floating point, and it's not crashing, so that's good. But you can go further than that, and before doing interval arithmetic, what we do is what we call static filters, which is computing using floating point, but also doing some static R analysis of the formulas, and I will give a bit more detail about this. And the conclusion here is that you get running times that are very good, very comparable to just floating point. It works for many problems, not everything.
Why is your interval arithmetic 10 times slower than a floating point? I would say a factor between 2 for addition, subtraction, and 4 for multiplication.
I think you have other, maybe 10 is something I don't remember, but it's at least 4. For multiplication, it's more painful than just additions and subtractions. Plus, you have the overhead of rounding mode changes.
For multiplication, okay.
And I will.
There is a trick by
Lambeuf,
where you can use SSE2 on you store the opposite of the lower bound, and then you use on
yeah.
the one.
Yes, that's what we do. I will give a bit more detail on the implementation of those things. So yeah, now we go into the details. So first I have a page on multi-precision, just to give you what we are using. So initially we were using multi-precision in integers. That came from actually LEDA, and then later for license reasons we also added the ability to use GMP instead. After that, LEDA and GMP were not enough or were both causing issues for portability and instability and stuff like that. And so I implemented something which is called MP float, which is actually a dyadic number, dyadic numbers, which is most, we do a lot of computations which are polynomial evaluations with inputs that are floating point. So dyadic is just the closure of those things. And so it's a good fit. And Sigal has a generic quotient class that can do rationals based on either integers or dyadic numbers, just a quotient, symbolic quotient of these. More recently, Mark Gliss implemented a class which is called GMPZF, which is a dyadic number based on GMP, because he said MPFR was not a good deal for that. So maybe that's something we can discuss. But essentially, yeah, I implemented the MPFloat class 15 years ago. I optimized for the speed of implementation. So it's not using any fancy algorithm. The multiplication is quadratic, for example. One original thing that I wanted to mention here is that I made the choice to actually optimize the sign bit, the storage of the sign bit, by using signed limbs, so just like machine is doing. I'm not sure many people are doing that, and I think with the experience I would not recommend it. But anyway, that's the way I did it. And the thing is, it's nice because it removes the dependence of Sigal on other libraries, so when you want to try it easily on another machine, you don't need to install something else. Mm-hmm. So think Windows and all those things, and think Windows 20 years ago too. So
are MP float on GMPZF available outside of Sigal? A separate library?
No, not as separate libraries. If you go to the Git repository of Sigal, you will see that it's organized in modules. So all the modules are independent,
mm-hmm.
and from the Git point of view, mostly I'm not sure actually. But it's not really meant to be installed separately. You could just install the whole thing and use the class that you want. Okay. Interval arithmetic now. What we did there is, as I said, mostly double precision, at least historically. I implemented this interval NT class also in Sigal, There was also libraries that existed, like Profibrias, whatever at the time. I don't remember exactly what existed for intervals. But I implemented my own mostly for portability, because when you do need to do rounding mode changes, it can be, or at the time at least, it was very unportable. You needed to tell the compiler to use volatile at some places so that it doesn't reorder operations, everything. So anyway, so Sigal has its own class. It's easier for the integration also of this arithmetic inside the algorithms of Sigal, the generosity aspect of it. And it's critical for the efficiency too. And it has a special mode for decreasing the number of rounding mode changes. So it has a mode where you can do, well, where it changes the rounding mode at each arithmetic operation. Mm-hmm. And it has a mode where it's supposed that it's already set towards a plus infinity, and so you don't need to redo it. Okay, and I wanted to mention that more recently, Luis Peñanda, he implemented a class called GMPFI, which is intervals, multi-precision intervals based on MPFR. And this is used for algebraic computations, higher degree things. I have not looked at the current status of this. I'm not sure if it's still very active. But at least it's there. Okay, so I said to go a bit faster than interval arithmetic, we also do some static rounding error analysis. This is mostly for a good set of predicates that are simple and that are signs of polynomial expression, so just like the simple orientation predicate. The idea is that you start from a bound on the input that is either known or that you can try to compute very quickly. And you try to find a quick way to deduce an error bound on the computed value. So there are several ways to do that. There are trade-offs between precision and speed. You can also have issues depending on the distribution of the data. If you have data that is on a grid or looks like it's mostly on a grid, then it can require some different ways to do that to get the most benefit of it. But we have those things. It's very kind of tricky to deduce those error bounds, etc. So there has been actually in the literature in the domain some work done on automatizing this. In Sigal, we developed a tool called FPG, Filtered Predicate Generator, that takes the kind of the expression of your predicate that is defined not in C++ but in a kind of specific language with a few annotations. And it generates the C++ version of the code that implements this filtering scheme. Some of it, I worked with Guillaume Melchion, and so we formal proved some pieces of it using Gapin and Koch. Okay, so that's the status there. A little bit on algebraic numbers. Yeah, so what do you do if you want to take the sign of this expression? Suppose that 2 is a variable and it happens to be 2 at runtime and you want to check that it's 0. In our community, there's been a lot of work in the 90s mostly using a refined numeric approximation, so just like ARM, with the separation bounds, that is, you can, if you have an algebraic expression, you can deduce a bound that says, based on the way that your number is defined, if it's smaller than a given bound, than a computed bound, then it's exactly 0. So this is implemented in 2 libraries, Leda and Core, and maybe some others as well. I don't know, really. But these are the 2 that Sigal interfaces with. And it's used in some places where you want, let's say, to compute arrangements of circular arcs or these kind of things. So it's mostly algebraic expression of low degree that work well on these. So square roots or k-th roots, these this kind of thing. But the nice thing is that you can compose those expressions. So you don't need to worry, it's very easy to use.
I'm a little bit lost with your example because you can simplify it to zero.
Yes, I know, you can do it by hand too.
So, yeah, but I mean, in that case, even writing it on the computer, I would first work modulo the defining polynomial. So if you work in a quadratic number field, everything can just be written as ax plus b, where x is the root of 2. So I agree if...
That's a bad example, I guess.
Afterwards, you can still want to, you still want to determine the sign. That is as an application.
But you have to distinguish between different roots of the same polynomial.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that's just a too simple example. The way that we use these kind of things is, for example, if you have an arrangement of circles, so you have a bunch of circles that's in the plane, you're going to compute the, or at least you need to refer to the intersections of those circles, so pairwise intersections. And if you want to compute the arrangement of this, so you want to compute the planar subdivision as a graph of this arrangement of circles, one way to do it is a sweep line algorithm. So you take a vertical line and you sweep like this. And one of the primitives that you are going to use is the comparison of the abscissas of these two things. So you have two numbers like this, I mean degree two algebraic numbers that you need to compare.
Okay.
So it's a plus square root of b and something like that, and you have an a prime plus square root of b prime, and you want to compare these two.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that's what it boils down to. Does that answer
your
question? Okay.
But you don't do it completely symbolically. It should be possible also, no? Using only integer arithmetic, rearranging.
Yes, you can do it.
Yes,
I'm sure you can do it. Actually, that's the last line of this slide here, which is the root of two number, which is a kind of symbolic. It's a bit like the rational number, the quotient class where you maintain numerator or denominator. This class here maintains ABC, which are the coefficients of your degree two polynomial, and you can just compare these, I mean, the roots without going to this kind of method.
Mm-hmm.
So you can do with only additions and multiplications on the coefficients of your polynomials. Okay, and there's this bit here, which is, so there's been a European project, ACS, where we were trying to go beyond simple low-degree algebraic curves. And so SIGAL is also interfaced with tools like RS, which can handle higher degree polynomial systems to do some more heavy algebraic computations. But I'm not sure it has some, well, first it needs to find its market. I'm not sure there is a lot of need for it. And I'm not sure it's fast enough, the results. So I'm not sure what the status is of this. I think it's a bit stopped. But anyway, it's definitely started. I mentioned GMPFI earlier. Very small side note, there is also some modular arithmetic in SIGAL. Initially, I had implemented some quick way to evaluate the sign of a determinant using modular arithmetic with a very fast implementation based on floating point. These days, there is modular arithmetic, but it's only used for quickly doing some zero testing, non-zero testing, and some determinants of polynomial expressions. Okay, so that's all the arithmetic tools that are there. Now I'm going to describe a bit how it's organized. So from a programming point of view, there is the arithmetic layer, and there is a little bit of algebra layer. That should be some more linear algebra thing, but it's not clearly defined. And then there's the geometry level, and then you have all the algorithms that make use of those. arithmetic types, they are organized in categories like this, so concepts in C++, and they list the various functionalities that you need on those. So for example, this, that's the base, and you only need addition, subtraction, multiplication, but not division, and you need comparison, I think. Then with this one, you need division, but only the division that divides exactly. If you need a field like rationals, then we use this one. If you need square roots. So essentially, it's a way to express the requirements of algorithms. And this is the way they are. There's a bunch of concrete classes like this. I just list that here for reference. So number types, you can refer to those types and do complicated computations with those. You can plug those types in kernels. So very simple Cartesian is the kernel that gives you a point type with xy coordinates that are of the number type that you choose. So it can be double or whatever you plug as a template parameter. And then you have kernels that are built on top of those and which integrates all the filtering schemes that are described. Filtered kernel, lazy kernel, and then you have some convenience types for users. Okay, I'm not sure I have time to go into those details. Do I need to speed up or? Okay. And I will try to be quick. It's mostly a C++ thing. It's the way that we, so how do we generate, when you have, let's say, 100 of predicates, how do you automatically generate the filtered version of a predicate automatically? So there is a tool called a factor adapter, which I implemented, called filter predicate, which does this. It's using functors and everything, so very functional programming thing, but that's what generic programming in C++ is. And essentially, it's doing two-step evaluation. So you first evaluate a predicate using interval arithmetic, for example, and you catch the exception if your interval is cannot conclude. And otherwise, you just re-evaluate the same thing, but instantiated with exact arithmetic. It's a very simplified way of saying it, but roughly that's the way that it's. That's for predicates, and we also have a way to do it for constructions, for geometric constructions. So if you implement a DAG, an expression tree of arithmetic expressions, you are going to store in memory a node with each operation. And let's say you compute an approximation with intervals, but you still need to memorize the whole thing so that if you need to recompute it, to reevaluate it, you can reevaluate the whole thing using exact arithmetic. More refined, more precise arithmetic. So this is what is done in core and lambda. One thing that we did is that we transferred this scheme at the geometry level, and instead of considering arithmetic expressions operations, we use those geometric constructions. So intersections, projections, midpoints. And so we manipulate segments and points at each node. And the advantage of this is that you have a big gain in terms of memory and speed. So something like a factor of 10 at least, but it depends on it. But you have many, many less, way less nodes to deal with and things like that.
So this means on the right, so in the coordinates of the m, the midpoint are say algebraic numbers of degree say 8. This means that every time you reevaluate your dagger, you recompute the polynomial of degree 8.
No, the way it's implemented is it's only two steps. So it's you start from intervals, let's say here.
Yeah.
So first you only have intervals.
Yeah.
And only if you need more precision in some way, then you are going to re-implement to re-evaluate all those nodes with an exact number type, which is going to encapsulate whatever algebraic thing you need.
Okay.
Here it's just proportional for this case, but
but for the exact type, then I wonder whether you really need a dagger, because you know you will be able to decide at the end.
Yeah, so once you have recomputed with an exact number, you can prune the dagger because you don't need the references anymore.
Okay.
Usually what it's done is that you compute exactly, then you recompute an interval out of it, which is going to be more precise for further computations, and then you can cut the tree. Yeah, so sometimes we need to decide if we want to rely on an external library or do it redo it internally. So I just listed some reasons why things are the way they are. So of course it depends on given decision at the beginning, but it depends on what is available, if it's portable enough, if it's easy to install on all the platforms that we need. It has some efficiency requirements, of course. It needs to be stable enough and mature enough. License can be also an issue. So the SIGAL project evolved over 20 years, and there's been 3 changes of license schemes. And so whatever we depend on needs to match somehow. Standardizability of something is also an issue. And also, yeah, sometimes things are the way they are because of just inertia and all the bad reasons, let's say.
Human factors.
Yes, yes, real life stuff. So conclusion, yeah, so what works well for SIGAL is the exact geometric computing paradigm as a base, let's say. And there's also lots of higher level algorithms that just use floating point or some, let's say, relatively just stable numerical things, and that works well enough. There are still some issues. Those constructions, graph, tree, DAG that I showed, when you want to cascade those, intervals grow and you get something that just cannot really escape. So far it's not been an issue in practice, but for example, when you build a large system, you cannot just switch the whole thing to exact arithmetic. At some levels, you need to just round it to the floating point grid because, for example, you need to pass the data to some other things. And so there is one big question which is done in some places. I mean, there are some algorithms, but it's still a problem in general, which is how do you preserve topology when you round something that is exact to the floating point grid. Am I clear?
Mm. Yeah, I wonder if you depends on what you mean by topology. You might even
topology of an arrangement of a geometric structure that has been computed.
But do you also want, for instance, that convex objects remain convex?
These kind of things, these kind of properties that you want to maintain on the rounded thing.
Mm-hmm.
So in general, it's not possible. But sometimes, so there are things where you can add point or merge points, or depending on the structure, there are some things that are specific and that exist, like start rounding. Non-algebraic numbers is something that has not been looked at. Something that I think would be nice actually to look at is to work further on this statistical analysis and try to do it within C++ as much as possible. So maybe an idea is to use Bohr arithmetic at the machine precision and try to do as much as you can as within the language. Maybe try to change the language if something is needed. And formal proofs also would be nice. So the arithmetic part is kind of at the bottom of the library. There has been some formal proof done at the geometric level, but it supposes that everything underneath is also proofed somehow, so it would be nice. And last slide of some acknowledgements. So I worked a lot on the arithmetic side of SIGAL, but I was not alone. So Olivier de Villers implemented an initial filtering scheme that has since been replaced. Mark Liss, I mentioned him, I think he worked on the GNPFZ class. Michel Hemmer and Louis Peñaranda, Monique Teo also, and all the Cigar editors and developers who provided feedback. And special thanks also to Marie Tividec, actually. She was the one who supervised me in my first internship in 95, which was on the subject of connection between geometry and arithmetic. Jean-Daniel Bossana, of course, and also Andreas Fabri and Geometry Factory, who are with the company that is now keeping the project alive in the commercial world. And thanks to the arithmetic libraries that I mentioned already, and the standards. And that's it.
Regarding performance, so usually you compute everything with floating point. So how much does the one of the slower arithmetic impact overall? How often is it called or?
So I did personally some lots of benchmarks on 3D DNA triangulations. If you consider, let's say, random data as the input, which is the one that usually works with floating point, otherwise you get crashes if you take the real data sets. But if you use this, if you take my naive class, the MP float class as the multi-precision engine, so it's quadratic multiplication I mentioned, but the precision is low. You are going to have maybe 200 bits maximum, something like that. So it's quadratic, but it's still constant. I think you get more than 100 times slower factor for the whole DNA triangulation computation. If you add intervals,
it's called quite frequently.
Yes. I think if you profile the thing with floating point, it's maybe 1/3 of the time spent in non-numerical things like memory management, setting your graphs, and all the algorithmic part of the code. And the rest is mostly numerical routines. So for DLNA, it's going to be locating the points that you want to insert, and then you have all the procedure to update your DLNA triangulation. So it's those two predicates, orientation and circle, that are very heavy. Yeah. And they are not optimized, you just see them.
This is a follow-up for this question. Do you have a published comparison of the different layers of arithmetic?
Yes, I can. So what I just mentioned, I have papers with benchmarks and things like that.
I'm interested to see the comparison with MPFloat, the GMPZF.
Yes, so for this one, so Mark Liss actually did it more recently.
Okay.
So you can talk to him. I'm not sure there is a publication on this.
Okay. And so you mentioned MPFI here. And so the GMPFI is using MPFI?
Actually,
or?
No. So maybe that's a mistake. the name is confusing, but actually I checked yesterday and it's based on MPFR. I'm not sure why it's not using it.
Would be interesting to know why.
So ask Louis for that.
MPFI was not very lively.
So, maybe there is this, but there can also be the way that it needs to interact with the code of SIGAL, and maybe too much things need to be done, how you set the precision.